Recorded Books in One-Click Digital present Dream Wheels by Richard Wagamese, narrated by Tom Stechschulte. Prologue. The old ones say that fate has a smell, a feel, a presence, a tactile heft in the air. Animals know it. It's what brings hunter and prey together. They recognize the ancient call, and there's a quickening in the blood that drives the senses into edginess, readiness. The wild spawned in the scent. It's why a wolf pack will halt their dash across a white tumble of snow to look at a man. Stand there in the sudden timeless quiet and gaze at him, solemn amber eyes dilating. The threat leaned forward before whirling as one dark body to disappear into the trees. They do that to return him to the wild, to make all things even once again, to restore proper knowledge. The old ones say animals bless a man with those moments by returning him to the senses he surrendered when he claimed language, knowledge, and invention as power. The great bull sensed it, and it shivered. The loose skin draped across its bulk belied the tough muscle and sinew that gave locomotive strength to its movement in the chute. The smell was in the air, the ancient smell. It gave a new and different air to the harsh light and dust of the arena. This was old, this scent, causing something to stir in its Indian and Spanish blood that it had never encountered before. Not death, not threat, not challenge, because the bull had faced those many times, no. This was more than that. This was more a bidding than an urge, a call forward, an invitation to spectacle, a beckoning to the edge the bull had never approached before. The bull shifted its 1,800 pounds, and there wasn't much room to spare on either side of its ribs. It didn't like the feel of the wood, the closeness, the thin prick of rough sawn board along its sides. The rage of others was dribbled into the board against its nose, and the bull shivered again and stamped its heavy cloven feet into the dirt of the arena floor. The noise of the crowd beyond the chutes rose and fell awkwardly against the babble of the cowboys, tugging and rubbing and plying leather in preparation amidst the jingle of metal, the snap and rub and crinkle of hard rope and the clomp of booted feet and the whinny and nicker of horses, unsettled by the turn of the air, the high, sharp slice of the ancient order that called to them now, too. A moment was coming, a confrontation. The bull bellowed once and banged the sides of the chute. Man feet scraped on the boards at its side, the side facing away from the open ocean of the infield, the man side. Out there, in the packed brown dirt rectangle pressed together by high wooden fencing, was his world. The one the bull controlled, the one they entered with the smell of fear high in the air. The men talked, their voices strained, tight in their throats, and the bull felt the abrasive itch of rope start around its shoulders. Just as the dull clank of cowbell rang beside him, the bull caught the flare of action between the boards of the chute as another bull and rider exploded into the arena. The noise of the crowd swelled incredibly, and there came the bashing and buckling sounds of leather, rope, bell, skin, and bone crashing against each other, amplified by coiling clouds of dirt that held it, gave it the shape, the tone, and snap of electrified energy. It didn't last long. A long, drawn-out sigh accompanied the rider, suddenly slammed into the dirt, the sound rising again as bright-costumed men raced about, attracting the bull's anger, diverting it away from the rider, who scrambled to his feet, eyes ablaze with a strange mix of indignation and fear, and leaped for the security of the fencing. The great bull bellowed to its cousin in the infield and shook the sides of the chute in celebration of another display of power. The men around it spoke bravely to each other, but the bull felt the anxiety creeping just beneath their words. It enjoyed that, and it bellowed again. The movement around the chute increased. Men in front of it were pulling rope against the gate that would soon fling open and send the bull careening into the light and heat and dirt of the battle. The men over top of its back moved silently, deliberately now, and the bull stamped and rolled back and forth, side to side, front to back in the chute, forcing them to agitation, their words harsher to each other. The rope about its shoulders was secured and the clank belt set in place. The heavy clink and rattle of the bell angered the bull. It dangled beneath it, heavy as another testicle, but irksome, foreign. And as its weight settled, the bull smelled the ancient smell again and rolled its eyes in their sockets to look upward at the men, rolling its head while it did so and giving the topmost boards a solid thwack and shiver. It watched the young man climb the fence, saw the set of his face, determined, calm, and strong beneath the fear, and felt the firm slap of his gloved hand on its neck as he leaned over, feet straddled on each side of the chute. The man bore the smell, too. The bull shifted in the chute, made a small bit of room to accommodate the legs of this man, who smelled so richly of that ancient call. It felt the dull, rounded rowl of spur against its flank as the man slid into place, and it shivered, the loose skin unsettling the man, feeling him grip with his thighs, searching for hold, finding it, and relaxing again. The bull snorted and half rose on its hind feet, twisting its head side to side and trumpeting the acceptance of this challenge and hearing the buzz of the crowd rise in time with its huge head over the top of the chute. The men spoke quicker, shorter words, snapped at each other, and the bull felt the waxed rope being pulled tighter and tighter about its girth. This was the call. This was the ancient order of things, the primal encounter, the scent of the coming together, bone to bone, blood to blood, and will to will. The bull understood this. It knew that the man straddling its back answered the same urge. The scent was high in the air now. Fate, destiny, life itself, keen as the wolf's call in its blood. The great bull bawled its challenge again and felt the air contract as the crowd drew breath, sensed the man tighten his grip, felt the pull and yank and strain of rope and the ripple of gloved fingers in the small hollow behind its shoulders. It reared again in the chute, wild, raging. The call driving it back into primordial time. He planted his feet on the third rail of the chute and allowed himself one quick look at the arena. It never failed to amaze him. People of all sorts gathered together to witness a part of his life that he had never quite learned to equate with spectacle. Joe Willie had always ridden as a matter of fact. From the time he could remember, he'd been straddling something. From his father's bouncing thigh in the living room to the pony at 3, the sheep at mutton busting at 4, the horses at 6, the steers at 8, and finally, the bulls at 10. Sticking and staying had come to him as naturally as walking and riding, lunging out of the chute on a bareback horse, a saddle bronc, or a bull like the champion Brahma Cross beneath him now was merely the definition of a life, a cowboy life. Bred in his Ojibwe Sioux bones as surely as this rodeo grew out of the old Wild West shows his great-grandfather had whooped and hollered and ridden in alongside old Buffalo Bill himself. Joe Willie shrugged. Too busy for those thoughts now, too busy to entertain anything but the feel of this great bull. The ribs of it threw the loose skin against his calves and thighs, telegraphing twists and jumps and kicks in a microsecond, reacting to it, sticking and staying. He needed to think ahead to that first mad plunge out of the chute. The dervish beneath him, whipping him forward 8 seconds in time to definition, truth, life itself. The bull was called C4, after the powerful military explosive and the number of seconds a rider would likely see on its back before its energy detonated completely and he was blown skyward to crash and eat arena dirt. Up to now, that name had held true. C4 was a living legend, unrideable, they said, bred of blood stock that had proven to be champion rodeo stock as well. C4 was a draw a cowboy did not want in any short go or preliminary round. He was a money killer. 1,800 pounds, nearly 6 feet high at the shoulder, with a hump from his Brahma roots swelling into a neck and head wider than a horse's haunches. Only the space between the shoulders allowed a rider any chance at all. Only there was their purchase. The slim chance to exist there, a tumultuous 8 seconds. Behind that slight margin, the bull owned everything. To slip beyond it, a cowboy could only hope to be thrown clear enough to escape the fury of the hooves and horns when he landed. Behind it was cataclysm. Joe Willie measured it from above. He rubbed the tough leather glove on his left hand against the inside of his thighs, allowing a little of the rosin to stick there. The bull had reared suddenly, causing him to lose his concentration, and he'd stepped up and off to reclaim his focus. Now he could feel the world narrowing in scope. He heaved a deep breath, heard the sound of the crowd shrinking, diminishing, the yells of the cowboys pulling backwards out of the air, until only a thick, heavy, muffled silence remained, where the creak of leather, the huff of the breath of the bull, his own tattered breath, and the thudded stamp of hoof on ground existed to be heard. Then he slid downward onto the brindled back of C4. Everything was slow motion now, from the clenching of his hand under the bull rope to the steady hauling in of tension on the same rope from his father's hands. His eyes unblinking, he saw nothing but the squashed, elongated U of the bull's horns. Peripherally, the slow-mo preparations of his friends and supporters keyed him up, excited him, edged him closer to the moment. He felt his father's hand on his shoulder and allowed himself a brief second to look and caught his steely-eyed nod. "Suicide rap," he said. "You sure?" "Gotta be," he said, gritting his teeth. His father nodded grimly, then began looping the bull rope between the fingers of Joe Willie's gloved hand. The wrap made it easier to hold the rope, but also made it 3 times harder to free the hand during or after the ride. Joe Willie watched as his father tended to the latch. This ride was everything. This ride was the ride to the top of the world. The rodeo announcer's voice seeped through.
"Coming out of the chute, number 3, a young cowboy who can take over the number 1 ranking for the title of all-round cowboy with a successful ride. He's already a champion in the saddle bronc and the bareback riding, and he's matched up here with the undefeated, unridden legend, C4. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, as tough as they come, a true cowboy, Joe Willie Wolfchild."
He heaved a deep, rib-expanding breath and let it go slowly. Beneath him, the bull shuddered once, then settled into a curious quiet. They sat there, connected by the bull rope and one gloved hand, waiting. There was a smell in the air. Joe Willie shook his head once quickly to clear it, shivered his legs against the bull's sides, raised his right arm slowly to clear the top rail of the chute, and nodded solemnly to the rope man at the front of the chute. And the world exploded. The great bull was true to his name. He detonated. The rage in him was complete and perfect and whole, and when the gate flew open, He felt it blast apart into a shrapnel of motion. There was no reason to it at first, just an explosion out of the chute, just a relinquishing of boundaries, just a launch into a space he understood the order of, implicitly. His eyes rolled back and upward, and he caught the flare of the lights as he raised his shoulders and then drove them downward with a powerful kick of his back hooves. The man's weight stayed where it was supposed to. He felt it settle into the pocket of flesh behind the bone of his shoulder, and he felt the twin kick of spurs against the bottom of his neck. When he landed after the first kick out of the chute, the bull began to reason. He felt the hand against his back. He felt the man's bulk pinned to that point, and the greater part of his weight leaned toward it, left. The bull understood the direction intuitively and knew that the man would struggle to maintain his position, the rest of his body toward the hand. He twisted violently the opposite way. C4 spun once, twice, three times, four times in a delirious circle. Kicking, bucking, head and shoulder rolling away from the strength of the hand on his back. Just at the height of the spin's energy, he halted it, kicked twice, arched his back, and bucked before spinning back to the hand side. The clank of the bell spiked into the center of his head, frenzied him, enraged him further, and he knew when the man was gone, the sound would disappear, so he spun. He spun and kicked and bucked against the bright whirl of the lights, the roar of the people far away across the ocean of dirt, and the splash of color of the other men bounding and leaping around his mad tear. He rolled his great head at them, bawled loudly, and thrashed his horns from side to side while kicking and throwing his rear the opposite direction. That's when he felt it. The slip, the loss of contact, the feel of air between the slamming buttocks of the man and his spine. He began to work the air. He ignored the man and focused his rage on that pocket of air, trying to increase it, stretch it, enlarge it, use it to separate the man from the rope around his shoulders. He drove all four hooves clear of the ground in a wild, hurtling leap that drew screams from those faraway people and a deep grunt from the man on his back. When his hooves slammed back into the earth, he spun again, and as he did, he kicked out, leaned away from the glove, and felt the air pop open, and he knew he'd won. He spun twice, then reversed it. When he did, he felt the man float free, felt him take to the air, except for the hand that stayed tight to the rope. This confused the bull. The weight was suddenly gone from his back, but presented itself now unpredictably at his side with a hard knock in the ribs as the man slammed into his flank, the pressure of the hand pulling fiercely to that side. He kicked and spun the other way, determined to end this. He felt the man dragged along. There were others now. The brightly colored men were racing about, screaming in man talk and waving at the bull, and others yelling and running and flailing their hats in his face. The ancient scent was high in the air, and the bull knew that this moment was the moment of challenge, of change, of fate and destiny. Every kick, every rise and fall of shoulders and haunches and torso was reduced to a silent roll, a trickle of motion, and even the terrible bawl that erupted from his throat spread across the air like the wave of tall grass in a light breeze. He felt the man's feet slump along through the dirt, dragged, hauled, torn along, and still the pressure of the hand and the rope around his shoulders stayed where it was. He felt blood in his nostrils, behind his eyes, and he kicked as never before to free himself, then rose and fell in silent time, and the bull felt the body twist around the arm, felt the back of the man's head thump against its shoulder, felt a tearing, a separation somewhere above the hand. And it worked that separation like it had worked the pocket of air before. It rolled its back toward the man and then away, and it felt the hand give, felt the rope slip and the horrible clank drop away to be smothered in the dirt. The bull kicked and spun in celebration of its freedom, and the men raced around it, trying to get to the man who lay in a heap on the ground. They disconcerted him. He wanted the quiet of the chute that led out of the arena now, but the men darting around his head made it hard for him to find it. He speared his horns at them to clear them from his way. He kicked, the crowd roared, and he saw the man he'd flung from his back try to stand. A hat was waved in his face, and he charged at it. When his vision cleared, all the bull could see was the man he'd thrown and the chute he wanted into beyond him. He charged toward it. He felt the puffy give of flesh and the snap of bone as he charged over the man, and he kicked backwards once when he was past it and felt the dull thunk of contact. The crowd noise was shrill and hard on his ears, and C4 trotted heavily into the chute to escape. As he moved deeper into the shadowed recess, he felt time regain itself, reassert itself, and he calmed gradually, glad of the escape. In the arena, time was still in disarray. Book One, The Arena. They came up through the draw, and he watched the dog run rabbits. He ran low to the ground, his nose skimming the grass, ears flat against his head, tail straight out behind him like a rudder, back paws kicking up tufts of dust so that even in his stealth, the flushing of rabbits from the brush took on the illusion of speed. When a hare bolted, the dog gave a short burst of pursuit, then idled back into the low prowl again. The man admired the old sheepdog's determination, even though time had erased the speed and agility of its youth. The 20 yards or so of chase was all the dog could manage now, but 14 years would do that to a dog. The man wouldn't mind a smidgen of that exuberance himself if he could get it. It was the best he could do sometimes to saddle up the old buckskin mare and take his evening ride. Old geezer. Coot. Funny how when you arrived at that marker, when you finally irrevocably qualified for it, everything in your life arrived there with you. Old dog, old horse, old saddle. He laughed to himself. 84, and he could still ride, still saddle his own mount, still muck out the stall and never suffer any ache. He never galloped, though, not anymore. No. Him and the old dog and the old horse merely walked now. Walked for an hour or so every night down the draw, along the river, through the trees a while, and then back up to the equipment shed to watch the sun go down behind the mountains. Then moseying homeward before it got too dark to cause the old woman any worry. The dog loped back and walked beside the horse, looking up at the old man as if looking for affirmation.
"I seen you," he said. "Them rabbits never had a chance."
The dog skipped off a few steps, and they eased out of the draw and onto the flat where the equipment shed sat at the far end of the main pasture. When they got there, he dismounted, dropped the reins so the horse could graze, gave it a rub along the neck, and walked toward the shed. He'd built it out here on purpose. It was his place. The one place on the whole ranch where no one interfered. Hell, no one ever really ventured there but him and the dog. It wasn't much more than boards and beams, but it didn't need to be. Inside, it was a maze of gear, tools, tack, saws, plowshares, axes, whiffle trees from the draft team he'd broken the ground with, engine parts, dead radios, a 1950s television, toys, snowshoes, rope, fishing gear, and rusted guns. Most people might have labeled it a mess, a confusion of junk. But to him, it was a museum. His story was here. The whole range of him and the hump and cluster and shadow and odor of the place. He loved the smell of old leather, oil, rope, and wood. The way he figured it, smell was the one sense that allowed you to hold on to things, to remember, recollect, reassemble a life, and he came here to do just that. The dog and him would climb up into the cab of the old truck, and he'd roll down the windows and sit there, staring at the line and curve and lurch of everything, remembering with small, satisfied nods of the head. Eventually, he'd focus on the panorama laid out beyond the door, and he'd sit and smoke and watch the sun go down, the dog's head laid across his lap. When he'd first come to this valley, there was nothing here but open pasture land and the woman's dreams. Her family were descendants of the gold miners who'd first opened the valley, and the property the ranch sat on had been hers from the day she was born. Her brothers' and sisters' places were on the adjoining sections. When she brought him here, he was incapable of seeing anything, but she saw it all. It was like she could see directly into the future. And as they stood there, on a night pretty much like the one he just rode through, she told him how it would be. It turned out almost to the word, and he loved her for that. Though in the beginning, he had his share of doubts. Back then, an Indian man and a white woman was still considered a strange union. The fact that he'd been nothing but a rodeo vagabond all his life, and she was the product of a settled family with land and money and a local name, did nothing to stall the talk when they got here. He drew back some when he was around people, but she strode right into a room, daring anyone to say anything to her or about her. And when she introduced him, it was with pride and a fierce, visible loyalty. He smiled. Folks never knew enough at first to avoid antagonizing her, but they learned quick enough. Couldn't help but. It took a year or so, but when the neighbors and the town folks saw his industry, the dawn-to-dark routine he put in building and clearing and stocking the place, the fact he never drank like they expected him to, and the fact that he and the woman clearly, outright, loved each other, they mellowed, and eventually, slowly, invisibly, they crossed the line into acceptance and, later, admiration. Now, 60 years later, they were merely Lionel and Victoria, and the ranch was merely Wolf Creek, and the talk was merely about their grandson, Joe Willie, the rodeo champion. 3 generations of Wolfchilds had lived on this land, and he nodded in satisfaction. She'd known all along that it would work. She'd known all along that love was enough to pan the gold of family out of the rough pasture land of this valley. She'd known all along that the lanky Indian cowboy she fell in love with at the Cheyenne Rodeo was the man she wanted to build it with. And he thanked her in his heart for that wisdom. The busted kneecap he got in Mesquite in 42 never healed up right, and after a season of trying to get past it, the bucking and falling got to be too much, and he'd had to hang up the spurs. They'd driven here in the truck, with his tack and gear thrown in the back. Rodeo was his blood, though, and once they'd got the place up and able to run, it was a natural choice for him to look at how he could still keep a hand in. Stock contracting was the easiest and surest way. With all his connections in the chutes and on the back lots, they'd had a built-in market. They'd made the rounds of local rodeos looking for brood stock, and the first bull they'd gotten turned out to be a prolific sire of rough-and-tumble bucking bulls. The horses were her concern, and she'd proven to have a keen eye for the wild, unpredictable nature required for good bucking broncs. It hadn't taken long. A few seasons later, they were turning out prime rodeo stock every year. He'd given up the trucking end of things when they started to ship too many head, and it kept him from the rodeos. He ached for it then, yearned for it like a lost love. But Birch took care of that. Birch had been a solid rodeo rider. He knew the ins and outs of sticking to a bronc, and he understood completely the narrow hunk of territory he needed to sit to ride a bull and how to stay there. He had a good career. The old truck had gotten Birch around the circuit, too. And remembering that, the old man reached out and rubbed a small circle of dust from the dashboard. Good truck. Loyal. Like it knew its role in the Wolfchild scheme of things, and had played it as long as it could. It died about the same time as Birch's career. Even though he was in the money more times than not, Birch never made the championship rounds. He was just a good, solid rodeo cowboy. Never spectacular, never the whole deal. Not like Joe Willie. Nope. His grandson was a pure natural. Tall and lean, wiry. He was built to ride, and from the moment he rode his first sheep, you could see that this boy's butt and the ground were not meant to meet up very often. He rode his first steer at 5, and from there, it was plain to see where he was headed. Birch and he had coached him on the bulls, and the woman had taught him horses. He could ride anything. He was a national team champion every year, and when he finally went full-time with the men, it was largely no contest at every rodeo he entered. With a few good rides at the national finals that night, he'd be world champion all-round cowboy. Champion in the saddle bronc, bareback, and bulls. It took a whole heap of cowboy to accomplish that, and Joe Willie was the purest rider the old man had ever seen. Joe Willie had made it possible for the ranch to become what it had. The championship money, endorsements, and appearance fees went into turning the ranch into a successful family enterprise. Wolfchild stock was regarded as the prime rodeo stock to be had, and the family worked hard to maintain both the bloodline and their connection to the sport. For him, it was the pleasure of all pleasures to look around him and see his family together in one place, bound by the dust and dirt, the scent and sound of rodeo. Family ties snug as a latigo strap. The dog barked, and the old man looked up to see her trot a horse up to the door of the shed.
"There's been an accident," she said.
"Joe Willie?" he asked.
"Yes." "It's not good, Lionel. It's not good at all."
Around him, the light faded into night. Claire Hartley barely moved. She kept her breathing small, short, measured. Each dollop of air gauged to keep her awake and maintain the calm, the stillness, the safety of the scant space between the top of her thighs and the back of the man's. Heat. The radiant warmth of her skin against his offered him sufficient assurance to sleep, snoring rhythmically, one hand thrown backwards, draped over her hip bone, the fingers contouring the curve of her buttocks. The whiskey smell spewed into the room with each snore. It seeped from his skin, hung in the air like the curses from an hour ago, and her throat constricted from its sour, sickly richness. The sex had been rough, it always was. He'd been demanding from the moment he reeled through the door, sweeping her into a fierce bear hug, feet off the floor, twirling her in a clumping caveman dance around the kitchen, his coarse, unshaven cheeks scraping against the sensitive skin of her neck, chafing, his tongue darting lasciviously against the back of her ear. Then he'd plopped her down on the counter, spread her knees with one large hand and inserted himself there, pulling her closer, plumbing her with his tongue, the tang of ferment from the after-work beers cloying, nearly gagging her, and his hands kneading the press of her rump on the counter. No words, there never were, only the grunt and moan and mutter of lust and her silence. It's what hurt the most. Her silence, the utter inability to even scream, protest, challenge the brutish intrusion, the invasion of her. She felt his hardness as he slid her off the counter, wrapped her legs about him, only to keep from tumbling them both to the floor, and felt the solid urge of him. The pots burbled gently on the stove, their wafted promise ignored, and she reached for the knob as they stumbled past, but it slid beyond her outstretched fingers. He'd thrown her onto the couch. She landed square on her back and bounced twice before her weight settled into the cushions. He'd stood there, unbuckling, unzipping, leering at her, talking now in a garbled mélange of curses and loutish description of her body, his desire, his intentions, his control. She didn't move. That was her part, the one he wanted her to play, the one he needed performed in order for him to move into the realm he needed to inhabit. Acquiescence, surrender. He needed surrender. The black woman silent before his power. She waited, wordlessly, and when he reached upward along her thigh and groped for the thin fabric of underwear, the humping of her rear was a preventative move, more than invitation. He yanked them from her. He pulled apart the zipper along the back of the thin sundress and threw it from her. He forgot about the shoes, he always did. Instead, he raised her heels above his shoulders and speared downward. She went places after that. She closed her eyes and traveled to the places she'd gone to all her life when the noise and the motion and the vision got to be too much for her. She went to the imagined freedom of the mountains. She went to a splendid day with the wind bringing the scent of juniper and pine and sage to her as she rode along a trail dappled with shadow. She felt the gentle bump of the saddle pommel against her womanhood. She felt the sway and step of the horse's girth between her thighs. She felt the polished leather rub rhythmically against her rear. She felt all that languid sensual motion, the antithesis of this savage pummeling of her vagina. Then she went to the boy's birth, the joy of it, the agony of bringing him to the light, the terrible hurt followed by the most incandescent beauty lying nestled in her arms. She went there. The boy was out. He always was. It was an unspoken pact between them that he would stay away until 9 or so before phoning and getting her mumbled, coded reply that all was settled there. She was glad of that. Glad that they knew enough of survival to engage in this alliance of deception, to allow the venom to spew before coming home to perform the perfunctory roles of home and family for his convenience. She went to the life the boy and she had shared. The measure of his company, the benchmark of what she knew as happiness. The man arched and bellowed like a great whale. He turned her, lifted her into the position he required, slapped, gripped, squeezed, bit, and battered her with his penis until the false stamina of booze gave way and he groaned loudly before collapsing on top of her, murmuring gentle noodlings of love in her ear. On clouds of boozy vapor. Then he'd sleep. If she woke him, he'd be angered, and the sullenness would last all evening, taken out on her and the boy in spiteful looks and curses before the booze took over again and he slumped to the bed and gave them reprieve. That's where she lay now, in the amnesty of orgasm. Soon, when he made even the smallest of moves, she would rise and repair dinner, serve it to him at the coffee table where he flicked through the channels seeking a ball game or action movie to fill his night. Dinner, laundry, neatening was the dance she did each night, the avoidance dance that got her to the place where he slept and she could relax, think, plot the escape she craved but felt helpless to effect. But tonight he turned and slipped a hand to her throat, pushing her back into the pillow and rising like an assassin in the dark. She closed her eyes and waited for the light of memory to take her back again to sunlight and space and freedom. It never came. Foley had never seen anything like it. The arm had been torn from the socket, and only the strength of the muscles had kept it from being separated from the torso. From the paramedic reports, he gathered that the young bull rider had been unable to free the latching hand from the bull and had been flopped about mercilessly for a good 30 seconds. It didn't seem like a long time, but when Foley considered the prospect of being whipped about by a ton of animal, it must have been an eternity. It must have seemed that way to the young cowboy, too. All the muscles had been ripped savagely. The deltoids, subscapularis, supraspinatus, and infraspinatus muscles were shredded. Shredded. The rotator cuff was gone, just gone. Disappeared, vanished. Vamoosed, as the cowboys would say. Right now, the shoulder set completely out of joint, and Foley suspected that the whiplash effect of the bull's thrashing, coupled with the twisting of the cowboy's body, had done the same to the ligaments as well. But that wasn't all that worried him. The young man's leg was fractured, not merely broken, but stomped, pulverized. Foley suspected the break had happened when the legs had been slammed to the ground and then the bull had galloped over him. The femur was a mess. When they'd rolled the gurney in through the doors, the cowboy was conscious. That surprised Foley. Normally, people in that much pain went into shock and lost consciousness, but the cowboy gripped his hand when he stooped to look at him, and Foley had felt the coiled strength of his grip.
"Bad, Doc? Huh?"
he asked.
"We'll see,"
Foley had told him. What he saw, he didn't like. All the normal attachments that connected the arm to the shoulder were gone. The joint could be pinned, perhaps, but the pinning could easily render the arm immobile, incapable of the normal round operation that allowed the arm to be lifted, turned inward and outward, swung. The leg would never be the same. He'd walk, but with a severe limp, and Foley knew he'd never ride again. At least, not as a competitive rider, not as rodeo bull rider. From the initial x-rays, Foley determined that the only solution appeared to be a rod down the middle of the bone itself, and then a series of screws to attach the bone fragments. 6 months down the road, after the cast was off, the cowboy could start strength exercises to build back muscle in the thigh, but the leg would never, ever bear the pounding of bull riding, perhaps not even riding a horse easily. The young man slept. The morphine had defeated his gritty hold on consciousness, and Foley's next move was to call in the bone specialist and prepare him for surgery on the leg. The arm would take some consultation, and Foley suspected the young cowboy was due for a lot of surgery over the next 24 hours. It was going to be tough, but from the tensile grip he'd felt earlier, he believed the young man possessed an inordinate amount of strength. He'd need it. A half dozen cowboys milled about in the emergency area. Foley had treated a number of them over the years and was always impressed with the way they shrugged it all off and began healing in their minds even before the necessary surgery. For them, it seemed a broken bone was a way of life, and even the concussions, the fractured ribs, punctured lungs, and assortment of other results of allowing yourself to be thrown about at will by a wild horse or bull were the price of admission to a lifestyle he couldn't, with his Ivy League background, comprehend. This was different, however. This was being taken right out of the life. This was the end of the trail. "Are there family members here?" Foley asked when he approached the group. "I'm Birch Wolfchild, Joe Willie's dad," a tall, lean, dark-haired man said, standing and reaching over to shake Foley's hand. "Mr. Wolfchild, your son's in pretty bad shape." "Well, he's been in pretty bad shape before, Doc. Not like this." Birch Wolfchild looked over his shoulder once at the other cowboys and then stepped closer to Foley. He put a hand on his shoulder and began walking slowly down the hallway, and Foley was surprised at how easily the man had gotten him to move along beside him. "Now, Doc, I'm going to have to tell his mother something. And it's going to have to be something she can take in. So give it to me straight, no gobbledygook." Foley grinned, despite himself.
"Gobbledygook aside, Mr. Wolfchild, I've never seen a shoulder so completely devastated. The thrashing of the bull ripped everything, and I mean everything, that once resembled a shoulder and left nothing. His leg is crushed and is going to take major surgery just to allow him to walk again. It's as bad a scenario as I've seen. It was Birch Wolfchild's turn to grin. You give it pretty good when you give it straight, don't you, Doc? Well, that's plain enough, I suppose.
I'm sorry to be so blunt, Foley said. But the truth is, Mr. Wolfchild, your son is going to need a whole lot more than surgery.
Like what? Birch asked.
Well, therapy, physiotherapy, and a lot of it, as well as therapy for the emotional scars of the injury.
Emotional scars? Head stuff?
Yes, head stuff. He's not going to be able to ride rodeo anymore.
Birch slumped against the wall.
Frankly, putting that arm back together again is going to require specialized surgery, and right now, I don't know for sure how long it'll take to rebuild it, or even if it can be rebuilt. The leg needs a steel rod to give it strength, and there's no way it'll ever be safe to take a tumble to the ground again. Now, as far as I know, you can't ride anything without strong arms and legs. When Joe Willie comes out of this, he's going to have to learn to cope with not being able to ride again. Can he do that? Foley asked.
The cowboy stared at the opposite wall for a long moment. Foley could see the mind working at registering what he'd just heard, and then the slow welling of tears at the corners of his eyes.
He needed 3 seconds. 3 seconds on that bull and he was world champion. Just a clean ride like the thousands he's had before. Me? I figured it was a surefire thing. Hell, Doc, I was even helping to spend the money in my head. It's all we've done. All we've done since he was 3 was live for this day. You know what all-around cowboy means, Doc?
No. I have an idea, but no, not really.
Birch pursed his lips.
It's like reaching for the hand of the prettiest woman at the dance.
The cowboy's got to be mighty lucky and mighty good. Joe Willie was mighty, mighty good.
I'm sorry, Foley said, recognizing the emptiness inherent in the words.
Birch nodded solemnly. I appreciate that.
The hardest part for all of us now is going to be not being at the dance.
He walked slowly back to the group of cowboys and Foley watched them talk. Foley could see the shock register, but become replaced almost instantly with a collective look of hardened composure. Grit, Foley thought. They circled around Wolfchild and Foley knew that the family would have the support it needed to get through this. And they'd need a lot. Silence was the rule. She knew that. She knew that passage through moments like this, moments when his lust was a raging thing, his need for control, dominance, and authority drove him to gripping, twisting, hitting, meant she needed to lie back and suffer it. Suffer it so it would end. So he could spend himself, roll off, and move into the stilted semblance of home life that he pulled around himself for the community's eyes. Why she spoke suddenly, she never knew. Only that for the briefest of instants, she saw herself beyond this, beyond the city, the routine, the performance piece her life had become, and the freedom, maybe, of a horse on a trail in the mountains. Back to the dream she'd once held out for her life. The word spilled from her like dream words do, all languorous and distracted sounding.
Eric, she said. He froze.
Shut up, he said and continued his humping.
Eric, no.
He froze. Slowly, he pulled himself out, got off her, then stood above the couch, slid his shorts over his thighs and stood there, looking down at her. Then he lit a cigarette,
took a swallow from his glass on the coffee table and sat down at the edge of the sofa. He smoked, and she wondered what this turn of silence from him might mean.
No,
he said in the darkness, as if the word puzzled him.
You tell me, no? Funny, I thought you loved me.
I do, Eric, she said. I do love you.
Do you?
He asked the darkness.
Do you?
He walked over to the small lampstand and clicked the light on. The room was bathed in a soft yellow glow. He walked to the window and drew the shades across, walked back toward her, and stopped to drain the glass before he spoke again.
Love says no?
Sometimes.
Yeah?
Yes. Sometimes it's not nice what you do,
he grinned.
It's not supposed to be nice.
That's not love, then, she said.
It's called making love, he said, stepping closer. Making love. It's how a man does it. And you, well, you just have to learn to like it.
No, she said, I don't.
He sat on the edge of the couch. She felt the weight of him, the bulk, the heft and girth of him, and she swallowed hard. He poured another shot of whiskey and held it up to the light and gazed at it, studying its amber color, swirling it a little. Then he tilted it back and swallowed it, all of it.
Nice, he said.
He reached back and slipped one large hand around her neck, not gripping, not squeezing, just placed it there while he put the glass on the coffee table with the other.
How's that? That nice?
No, she said.
There's that word again.
The grip tightened. He turned as he increased the pressure, and Claire's hands went to his thick wrist. He brushed them off with the other hand, grabbed her around the neck with both, and pulled her toward him. She was small, 5'2", a shade above 100 pounds, and he hauled her like a toy. He stood and dragged her across the couch, backwards, so that her feet slumped to the floor, and he pulled her to stand in front of him, his hands still clutched about her neck.
There, he said. That's nice.
She looked at him steadily. Don't show fear, she thought, even though the tentacles of it snaked through her belly. Whatever he wanted, she would do, quietly, wordlessly, just to get it over with and out of the way, just so she could move on to the zombie dance, the ritual evening, just so she could get to the sleeping part of her life, the normal part. He smiled at her, and she saw the man she'd run into at Smokey's Bar and Grill, the smooth talker with the laugh lines that punctuated his talk, the salesman that talked her into this new and better model of a life, the one who told her that she needed a businessman and not the run-of-the-mill tradesman, the workaday slacker she'd run with until him. The one who promised her and the boy a shelter and a rest from all the endless, tiresome searches she'd been on for love and home and belonging. The one who dressed her up and moved her through her life like a doll in a fancy doll's house, placing her here, placing her there, telling her how it was going to be until the lights went down and he threw her wherever he wanted. They weren't laugh lines after all. She saw that now in the light and the strain of his anger. They were wrinkles, old, tired wrinkles, and he was an old and tired man struggling to stay young through this staged life with a beautiful younger black woman. She saw that clearly right then.
You know what else is nice?
He asked. She shook her head.
This, he said,
sliding the shorts down and pushing her to her knees in front of him. She stared at his engorged need, and the revulsion was thick in her.
Now,
Be nice, he said.
No,
she said in a whisper. His fist crashed into the back of her head and drove her to the floor. She only had a moment to interpret what was happening before he kicked her in the stomach and hauled her to her feet again in front of him. Be nice, he said again firmly.
No,
she said. The world exploded. Victoria Wolfchild placed the telephone back in its cradle and walked to the picture window and looked out over the pasture. The horses were looped to the hitching post at the edge of the veranda, and the dog lay panting on the step beside them. She could see the back of him, leaned against the rail fence, looking across the valley at the mountains, smoking. She watched his ribs move out with the inhale, then contract slowly as the plume of smoke streamed out in a long, thin cloud, mushrooming at its end and disappearing into the purple-pink scalloped edges of the evening. Right now, he was learning to digest the disappointment and the worry. Las Vegas was thousands of miles away, and the distance felt even greater when you were landlocked and helpless at home. He'd want to be doing something, anything. Now, as she reached into the closet for her shawl, Victoria Wolfchild knew he'd be more wrought with anxiety once she told him the extent of the injuries. A star had fallen, and the sky was suddenly emptier and colder. Joe Willie had ridden higher and further than either he or Birch had ever dreamed, and the old man wanted that championship for him more than he'd wanted anything these past few years. Still, it was the fact that the boy was hurt and hurt bad that agonized him now. As she stepped through the door onto the veranda, she heard the faint syllables of the old prayer song they'd learned together many years ago. His face was raised to the sky now, and she knew his eyes would be closed and his throat open to beseech blessings for the grandchild far away. He hadn't had much use for the old ways when they met. Lionel had been raised in missionary schools. He never spoke of that. Victoria had made it a point to read what she could find of the experience, and she'd felt a well of shame for that part of her country's history. She knew that they had removed the language and the culture from those poor children, and that once a tribal person had lost those, they were pretty much at sea. So after they'd been married a few years, she started taking him to local powwows and tribal gatherings. He was reluctant at first, not so much for the encounter with his cultural way, but more because, even though Lionel loved her immensely, there was a part of him that felt embarrassed being married to a white woman. A cultural embarrassment that only played itself out when they walked among his people. Victoria sensed it in the way his hand let go of hers some when they walked. Not completely, not in any obvious way, but enough. She knew it in the way he looked beyond her when they talked, as if he needed to see who was looking. She knew it by his retreat into shorter sentences spoken lower than usual, or by his rapt interest in the ground. It was something else he never spoke of, but she knew it in her bones, and she also knew that she didn't blame him or hold it against him. The world sometimes held a big eraser in its hand, and it didn't care much whose life it skimmed over, didn't consider the impact of its movements. Those whose lives were smudged by it went on with a hunger for the edges, for definition, for completeness. Lionel needed detail, and she helped him find it. They'd found an old man and his wife, and they'd become regular visitors. The old couple spoke to them of the traditions that had once flourished, told them of the ceremonies and rituals that had once guided the lives of the people. Little by little, they had filled out the edges of Lionel's life. They filled out the edges of their marriage, too. Together, they had found a spirituality that fit both of them like an old pair of moccasins, loose, familiar, and comforting. She didn't know when it changed for him,
only that there was suddenly a time at a gathering in Montana that he'd stood there in a circle of his people and draped an arm around her shoulders while he sang along with a round dance song. They danced the owl dance together that night and the rabbit dance, and as Victoria looked out at the faces watching the couples step proudly by, she saw only joy and love and acceptance in their faces and on Lionel's, too. By the time Birch came around in 1950, they both spoke a smattering of Ojibwe and knew various prayer songs like the one the old man sang now with his face raised to the darkening sky. They didn't do so much ceremony anymore. The old bones couldn't take the cramp of the sweat lodge, and they'd settled for some time now on smudging with the sacred medicines, prayers, and meditation in the morning and the songs they'd sing sometimes with the old hand drum that graced the wall of their living room. She stood on the veranda steps and listened to him sing, the syllables rich and healing, seeping into the air, the grass, and the mountains like blessings. When he finished, he put one foot back onto the low rail of the fence and put his hat back on. She walked down the steps and along the crushed stone pathway. He heard the crunch of her footsteps and turned. When she reached him, she took his hand wordlessly and began to stroll along the fence line. She felt his gaze and his anxiety.
"Gizi Gokwe is happy tonight," she said. "Sky woman?" he asked, looking up and around at the sky. "Yes. I guess she is. It's beautiful. I never tire of it, this land, this sky, the mountains." "No, me neither," he said. "We've grown strong here, Lionel. Grown pretty damn old, too. Nice when it happens at the same time, isn't it?" "What are you telling me, woman?"
He looked down at her.
"Joe Willie's bad," she said, turning to him and taking both his hands in hers. "He won't ever ride again. The bull destroyed his shoulder and crushed his thigh."
She watched his eyes change. He looked up across the valley and heaved a deep sigh. Then he looked at her and nodded.
"He'll mend here," he said.
"Yes."
"Gonna need a lot of mending."
"Yes," she said again.
"Bones'll set," he said. "Hard work to mend a busted life."
They walked together back to the house to make a room ready for their grandchild. He sat on the edge of the bed and watched himself in the mirror. He practiced lowering and raising his head, keeping the eyes firm on themselves. Then, turning slightly to the right and to the left, the eyes, even in the narrowed peripheral field, cold, flat, emotionless, empty of everything but the idle threat, the danger lurking just beneath the surface. When he got so he could sweep the look across the room and not break the intensity, he stood and practiced leaning. All the weight on the flat of one foot, a hip thrust out, and the shoulders canted at an angle to match the hip and the arms dangling loose, casual, and the hands just slightly to the front of the hip pockets with the fingers cupped inward slightly, just so. The thumbs angled toward each other, giving the impression of fists forming in readiness. The will slouched and insouciant, prepared for battle. Then he walked. He ambled slowly toward the mirror, watching. He kept his eyes flat, his head tilted slightly, and walked, rolling the shoulders easily with each step, the hands never moving from their position. The plant of each foot was resolute, as if he was going somewhere important but a place of his own choosing, at his own time, his own tempo, the laziness of it a measure of his purpose. He walked until he perfected it, over and over, back and forth, watching himself, the look cast back across his shoulder as he spun slowly toward himself again, catching his own eye and seeing the warrior there, the unyielding ambivalence he needed to carry to the street. He was 15, but he walked 19. That was important. In the neighborhood she'd moved him to this time, he couldn't afford to be mistaken for a slacker, a mark, an easy number. The boys played rough here. There were four gangs in the area, and as a half-blood, he didn't really fit into any of them. Too light for the blacks, too dark for the whiteys and Latinos, and definitely too exotic for the Asians. There were no mulatto gangs. He was alone here, and he felt the weight of his isolation every time he hit the street, the disdain, the anger his obvious mixed blood caused in people. It was a dangerous place to be without backup. But he wasn't the type to roll over. He'd been alone all his life, and he'd come to prefer it that way. Every time there was a man, they moved, and there was always a man, and there was always a new neighborhood, a new school, a new set of faces and attitudes, a new challenge from the bully of the block or the leader of the local crew. But he survived. He'd made it to 15 in his aloneness and preferred it to the unpredictable volatility of the gang. So he practiced. He taught himself to walk. He walked to the mirror over and over again, slouching, the roll of the hips and shoulders less pronounced than the gangbangers. More a suggestion, really, than a salute. And when he neared the glass, he stepped slowly up to it, his face mere inches away and the eyes steady, empty as a promise from the revolving door of instant dads he'd known all his life. When he said his name, it was with the coolness of the hoods he'd watched on video, the detachment itself a threat, a devil-may-care shrugging off of responsibility, conscience, association. Aiden Hartley, he said to the mirror, his voice low in his throat. He said it again, slower. Then he smirked, just enough. There was a plate of food on his bedside table. He sat there and ate slowly, watching his movements in the mirror. He always ate later. Once they were tucked away in the bedroom, he'd come back and slip up to his room to watch TV late into the night. He hated the sounds, and even the dopiness of late-night TV was better than the slap and grunt and squeaking from across the hall. For a fat fuck, the guy could get it going every damn night, and he wondered if she liked his doughy whiteness jiggling above her in the dimness of their room. Probably. Sometimes he carried a wish for his mother. He wished that she could just float away, float right the fuck away from the endless searching and hoping and coming and going, the relentless to and fro of her life. Other times, most times, he resented her. She'd stick it out here, though, like she always did, hoping against hope that this guy was the guy and they would have a home and a history. He never could figure that one out, history. She went after it like she believed their life would start when she found it, and he figured they'd been having one all along. Not much of one in the long scheme of things, but it was a history nonetheless. So he found himself hoping that the fat guy with the money, the big car, and the nice house would be the one for her. Personally, he didn't care one way or the other. New guys were like new starts, same old. Old buddy-buddy in the beginning until they got in her pants, and once the thrill of that was gone, the slow downward tilt to the dump that always came. He'd picked himself up off more sidewalks than a wino by 15, and he was tired of it. All he knew for certain was that this last stop on the long train ride to wherever they were meant to get to was another brief disembarkation, a whistle stop, and he hated it like he'd hated all the others. He ate. Then he switched on the television and sat in its glow and watched one show after another, until sleep allowed him a reprieve, and he floated away himself. Birch Wolfchild had never really liked his name. He could see the strength of it. He knew that birch was a sacred thing with his father's people. He knew that the ancient legends and stories of the Ojibwe were inscribed on birch bark scrolls, and that the talking stick used in community ceremony came from the birch tree. He knew all of that and appreciated the fact that his was an honor name. But it was still no name to lay on a rodeo kid. Cowboy kids had no head for elaborate ideas, and their guffaws and snickers irritated the hell out of them. He'd even talked of taking on a nickname, something more appealing to a cowboy's sense of things. Rusty, Slim, or Tex would have worked for him, but his mother had told him all his life that Birch was a storyteller's name, and he was meant to bring stories forward. What kind of stories Birch never knew, but now, waiting for Johanna, he hoped that he had a few in store for his boy. His wife was a Sioux woman, a barrel racer and composed of the no-nonsense way of her people and a competitive rider. She'd brook no stories, and Birch had learned over time to lay everything out simple and direct. It was sure a lot less stressful on him that way. Johanna Wolfchild was a fiercely protective mother, and from the beginning, she'd wanted the straight goods on every bump and bruise Joe Willie had suffered. There never had been any way either Birch or his son could, their way past Johanna's scrutiny. Now, she'd wanted as straight as the doc had given it to him, and Birch knew that she would be the one to take it to Joe Willie when it was time. She always had. She'd raised the boy to face life head on and to teach him that she'd never once shrunk from the truth of things, no matter how hard that truth might be. That was the Sioux way, Birch figured. Warrior people. The whole today is a good day to die thing always puzzled him, but he saw it in his wife, and he loved her for it. When you knew who you were, all of it, the good and the bad, the pretty and the plain, you could face anything and never bend, bolt, or buckle. She taught him that. When it became clear that Birch was never going to live in the big money on the circuit, she just handed him his bag, got into the truck, and drove them home to the valley. Hardly even stopped for gas on the way, Birch joked, and she hadn't. Their marriage was the same no-nonsense deal. When Johanna knew what she wanted, she just roped it, tied it down, and took it home. She had with Birch, and he was the better man for it. From the moment she'd walked him away from his friends and out onto the dance floor at the cowboy dance in Pendleton, Johanna had moved him and his life onward and upward. He'd always been strong and tough, but Johanna had found a way to make him graceful. Birch grinned at that, graceful. You didn't learn to cowboy by being graceful, but you learned to be a man that way. First thing you had to learn in order to cowboy well was how to fall. First thing you had to learn to be a man was how to stand up, dust yourself off, and move on. The grace was in the dusting off. He waited as patiently as he could, but the closeness of the walls and the sickly pale green made him ache for air. His friends had headed across the way to a restaurant, so Birch stepped outside for a quiet smoke. She hated that. Johanna had been raised in the traditions of her people, and for her, tobacco remained a sacred plant, a medicine, as she called it. Birch figured he could use a little medicine right about now. He'd just fired up the cigarette and had a first good long haul when the cab pulled up at the door. Johanna Wolfchild always made Birch feel helpless. Not helpless like he couldn't move without her, but helpless like the feeling he got the first time he delivered a foal and felt its life warm and wet in his hands. Helpless because the magic in that left him in awe, silenced by its purity and the unrestricted beauty that radiated through his hands and filled his body. That kind of helpless, always. She was regal, tall, slender, but moving with a sure strength that caught a man's attention and held it. Long black hair, graying some now,
framing hazel eyes that Birch called cougar eyes for their mystery and lazy sensuality. Those eyes looked at him now, and he ground the cigarette out under his heel.
"You'll want to pick that up and put it somewhere," she said over her shoulder as she paid the driver.
"Directly," Birch said, bending to retrieve the butt. She walked over and stood in front of him. When he looked at her, Birch felt opened up, like any secrets he might have held at all got laid right open in the air. Known, seen, appreciated. She held the look a long moment, then offered a small crinkle of smile at the corner of her mouth before reaching a hand to Birch's face and laying a palm softly against his cheek.
"How are you?" she asked.
"All right," he said. "Well, as good as can be expected."
"It's not good, is it?"
"No, it's not." Birch put a hand on her elbow and guided her through the doors and down the hallway to the small waiting area. People stopped what they were doing to look at her. They always did. Whether it was in the back lot at a rodeo, a stock auction, or a shopping mall in some huge city, Johanna always got their attention. He sat her down in a chair and got her a cup of water. She took a small sip and straightened herself in the chair.
"Okay, so what is it?" she asked.
"It's his left shoulder and his right leg," Birch said. And for the next few long, hard minutes, he repeated what the doctor had told him. Johanna never moved. She sat and watched Birch as he spoke. When he finished, she raised the cup to her mouth and sipped from it until it was empty. Then she placed it delicately in the wastebasket beside her, put her hands in her lap, pursed her lips, and looked away across the room to some vanishing point far away.
"Suicide rap," she said.
"Yes," she nodded and looked at him solemnly.
"I'd have gone the same way," she said. "I'd have made the same choice, and so would you."
"Yes," Birch said again, quieter, more deliberate.
"So don't go harboring any thinking in your cowboy head that you might have changed this or that you're to blame because you didn't talk him out of it. We raised a man, Birch. We raised a cowboy. Joe Willie wanted this as bad as he ever wanted anything, and he made the choice, not you, not me, not anybody. Now he's got to heal, and we're going to help him. Simple as that."
"Yes," Birch said.
"Where is he?"
"Bed 5, in there," Birch said, pointing.
"I'll see my boy then," she said.
"He's doped out."
"No matter. I'll see him anyway," she said.
He strolled toward the youth center, catching his image in the storefronts as he passed. A few gangbangers checked him out as he passed. He kept his eyes front, and when they moved, he flipped them a sideways look, casual, unperturbed, and they let him pass. He'd had his share of fights, and the thought of violence didn't scare him, but he was sure he didn't want to be swarmed. No one needed that. So he worked on giving off the persona of a stand-up guy, to be known as a stand-up guy, someone who could take care of his own business, who had a mouth, who could fight, but take a trimming too. Someone who knew the code of the street and stood by it was all he wanted. That, and to be left alone. One of the Asian gang caught his eye and they nodded solemnly to each other, and he grinned when he'd passed. The youth center was tucked in at the far edge of a large park. Generally, it was a neutral zone, and since none of the gangs claimed the park as their own, it was a family place with dogs and strollers and games being played. He watched the people as he passed and wondered what the glue was that made them all fit together, to stick, to stay and be a predictable thing. It was a mystery to him, and when he felt a longing rise in him, he lit a cigarette and clamped it down firmly. The longing always made him mad, and the anger had a bitter taste in the back of his throat. He didn't trust that. It was dark there, and the darkness held things,
ill-defined things, scary things, and he had no time for being scared. Instead, he had a plan. A plan for moving beyond the gypsy life of tagging along behind his mother, a plan that would show her and everyone that he had the balls and brains of a stand-up guy, standing on his own and calling his own shots, and definitely someone who did not need anybody, ever. When the time came, they would all know that he was no one to mess with. The gangs, his mother, the school, and all the hollow men who'd come and gone, leaving nothing behind them but the stale smell of their cigars and booze and sex. Especially them, he'd show them. He'd show them all. The youth center was less than a hub of activity. Inside, a handful of kids played basketball and ping pong, while another clump of them sat twitching anxiously in front of a large screen TV where some action movie played. He watched for a while from behind them, but the movie didn't hold his attention for long, and he opted for roaming about idly. The staff members merely nodded to him, and no one approached to introduce themselves or to make him feel any sense of welcome at all. Eventually, he wandered out back to where four picnic tables made up the smoking area. "Got a smoke?" a lanky kid asked. "Yeah," he said, and flipped him the pack. "You're new here." "Yeah, kind of dead, though," Aiden said. "Get used to it. Anyone who comes here is not hooked up. It's the only place that's not someone's turf," the kid said. "So, what's to do?" Aiden asked. They give us passes to the movies, bowling, sometimes coupons for the arcade, lame shit like that." "How long you been coming here?" "About a month." "Long time to be bored shitless." "Any time's a long time for that." "You know it." "I'm Aiden." "Court," the kid said. "Court?" "Yeah. Funny, eh? Gave me a name for the place I'd spend most of my time."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.